I'm talking to Dennis Duncan. Good morning, Dennis.
Good morning, John.
Dennis is a branch manager and the only producing loan officer at his company in his area for Chase. And today it's the 22nd. It's raining like crazy out there. What kind of weather you got down there?
Well, it came through here probably 4 or 5 hours ago. So we've got the sun starting to come out in the dew and the remaining rain burning off this morning.
Yeah, well, I'm just saying we got a monster one out here. Let me ask you the first question I always ask everybody because everybody's interested. Where do you come from and how did you end up in your market area? Perhaps you could tell us a little bit about your market area.
Well, I stayed in my hometown, my home area, I guess. I graduated from Virginia Tech in 1978 and tried to get into banking out of college and was told my grades were too good and I didn't have the people skills to become a salesperson. So I got into pharmaceutical sales for a couple of years right out of college.
That's a good background. I'm familiar with that.
Right.
To get in sales.
And basically after 2 years in pharmaceutical sales, then I happened to get on as a mortgage loan interviewer with a bank and worked really for a bank as a in-house loan officer for about 4 or 5 years. And what happened is the bank got out of the mortgage business due to deregulation of deposits, and I was forced to become a pure mortgage banker if I wanted to keep my job. So I developed and started doing FHA and VA loans, more or less just taught myself how to do it and learned by telephone from some other people that I knew in the industry.
Well, you have a very unusual background because as a matter of fact, a historical fact too, because you've done it for a while, you do more units than anybody else at Chase. And I just wondered if you would tell us a little bit about your market area because it's very interesting and your average loan amount.
Well, Blacksburg is the home of Virginia Tech. It's, I guess, a college town, and then that's the major industry in Blacksburg. And you have several other manufacturing plants. Volvo, Corning has a plant. Celanese has plants here, but the main industry is the college. The average loan size when I started here in the market was probably about $75,000, and that's grown to maybe about $115,000, $120,000. And the most rapid growth has come in the last 4 or 5 years with the Virginia Tech has established a research facility and is starting to track a lot of high-tech industries. Cows, not the cows, but the sheep were cloned here a few weeks ago. It's biotech, technology, cellular phone technology, and internet technology. So it's a rapidly growing area, and as such, the income per capita has really increased, and we're starting to get a lot larger loan sizes.
Mm. How many loans, how many units do you do a year, on average?
On an average, I'll do at least 500. My best year was probably 93 and 92 and 93. I guess those 2 years I probably did 700 and 20 some units each of those years. But in 98, I got larger loan sizes and didn't. I guess I got more income for less work. But I got my dollar volume up to about $75 million, and I did that with like 600 units.
Mm. That's phenomenal for an area like that. You wouldn't normally think of an area that can produce that kind of volume, and yet I interviewed Don Ehrman, at Crestor or SunTrust, and down in Harrisonburg, and he has kind of the same kind of situation as you can imagine down there being a college town. So my guess is you own that town.
Well, a chunk of it.
From a mortgage standpoint, of course. Let me ask you something. What do you concentrate on? Are you doing a lot of governments, FHA, VAs, or?
I'll do about 30% government. I've been able to expand. Being a branch manager, I recognize the need for the branch to make a profit, and the government loans have greater servicing value. So as time has evolved, I've worked very hard to get our FHA limit increased. When I first came here, the FHA limit was like 68.3 or 67.7, something like that. And over the years, I guess each fall, I will go in and do an analysis of our market with the help from some of the board members of the Board of Realtors here, and then go to HUD to get our limit increased. And, you know, we've now got the Montgomery County limit up to like 128 to 250, which is allowing us to do a lot more government loans. And so about 30% of my business will be FHA, VA business, and the remainder will be conforming conventional. We'll do 15 or 20 jumbo loans a year.
Well, that's all. Are you doing any VHDA type, which is a state program for our listeners?
I do that. You know, we offer it. I don't do a tremendous volume. At one time, I used to be one of the largest VHDA lenders in the state, certainly the western part of the state. But basically, I try to lay all the cards on the table for a customer, and that volume has dropped off a lot due to the recapture tax and all the regulation. Most people, you know, there's this very small percentage in interest rate differential, and most people, they'll opt for one of the programs with less strings attached if they can qualify.
Mm-hmm. What are some of those strings? I kind of leading you on, I know some of the answers because years ago I did the VHDAs, and I know some of the problems with it.
Well, the biggest thing is the recapture tax, where if you sell your house in the first 10 years, you can lose up to, I guess, half of your profit. And that tax is not really a result of VHDA. It's a result of the Treasury Department trying to maximize its tax revenue. But if you sell your house in the first 10 years, basically you would have to, if your income has gone up by a certain amount, then you could be subject to losing up to half of your profit. And it's scaled to kick in about year 4 and 5 and 6 is when it peaks, when most people would be likely to turn that first house.
Mm. I think, aren't there also some assumability problems too, restrictions?
Yeah.
Used to be.
There'll be some income limits and maybe a little bit tighter restrictions on the property. But there's just so many other programs out there right now for the first-time home buyer. Chase has a 103% loan product right now that has no income restrictions at all. You've got FHA limits up here in Montgomery County. We work a lot with the Nehemiah, which is a grant program that you can kind of piggyback on an FHA loan and get a person in with FHA credit standards with just a 1% down payment.
Mm-hmm. Let's go back in time a little bit. It's obvious that you had a very good grounding because of your personal history and working with the bank, but that never explains everything. And I'm curious how you ended up being so successful when you converted over to a commission loan officer. What did you do that you think ensured your success?
I think initially it was product knowledge. I felt like that I wanted to be the best person out there, and I always looked at it from the customer's perspective. I knew that the more products I had access to, and the more well-versed I was in those products, then the better job I could do with a customer. But I think my volume really started taking off in the late 80s and early 90s when I started using computers. You know, I was fortunate enough to attend a banking school at the other university in Virginia besides Virginia Tech, and I'll say that's the one thing I learned from the Cavaliers over the years is you know, the use of a computer. I took a 1-week class in Lotus, and basically came back to my office and realized, hey, this can make a lot of a routine, mundane task. I can turn them a whole lot quicker. So I started writing programs to make sales presentations, good faith estimates to customers, spreadsheets. You know, one of the biggest things I use the computer for is I can sit down and run take a new listing as it comes on the market and run a spreadsheet that will give like 20 different financing options. It will provide monthly payments. It will provide the minimum income needed to qualify, the maximum debt load, and I can really mass produce and mass market with the use of the computer. And it's a big time function. I think that's the big difference, that I can get 150 more units out of my production. On a typical year, like the last 3 or 4 years with Chase, my unit production will be at least 150 more units than the next loan officer. You come into my office, and I'll typically be using two laptops and a freestanding computer at any given time.
That's amazing. Because I talked to very few people who are as tech-savvy as you are, and I happen to know it because we've talked a couple times, what are some specific things that you would recommend in the tech side of the business that loan officers out there do, whether the new loan officers or even very experienced loan officers that are don't have that tech background? Because it's never too late in this business to become tech-savvy.
Well, basically, I think you still need the product knowledge. You know, a lot of these new software programs, like we use LoanSoft product to originate loans now, and you almost don't even need to know how to calculate an FHA maximum loan amount and things like that. But I think it's still important that you know the underlying calculations and how to do them manually, so that you have just a real intricate knowledge as to how and which program you can go with. But the other end of the computer part is the sales end, which I think is where I have benefited. I see a lot of loan officers out there that I would call them the donut loan officers. They take by a stack of donuts to an office and expect that to ring in the business. And I've always been of the position that I need to give that realtor ways to make money. If I can feed that realtor by helping him get sales, then that's where I can do the most for them. And that's how I do the open house spreadsheets. We do pre-qualifies free. I devised a website where and that's something that's been a time efficiency for me. I've designed a website where a client, if I'm with a customer and my assistant happens to be tied up, or even right now while I'm talking to you, if someone calls in wanting to get pre-qualified, my staff can refer them to my webpage. They can download some very generic data to me. I can pull that into a Lotus spreadsheet and immediately break down their situation. And we talked earlier about getting larger loan amounts, and that's how, being able to break down that customer's finances. I typically tell a story about a client that came into the town from California about 3 years ago, and they were working for a realtor, and the realtor was wasting a lot of gas driving around town trying to find them a $100,000 house. It just wasn't going to happen in Blacksburg, perhaps Montgomery County, but not Blacksburg. And finally she said, who pre-qualified you? And she came back and said, well, let's go to Dennis. I think maybe we might be able to do more. And as a result of having that computer program and being able to break down, specific sets of scenarios, I ended up pre-qualifying them for like a $132,000 house, which they eventually bought. And it's quite a sizable increase in the transaction size for the realtor. And I don't think they would have ever found a house at the $99,000 price range.
Do the realtors know you have this program out there?
And oh, yes.
Is this a proprietary program?
Yeah, they think it's magic. And the thing that I like about it, I've become so adept in Lotus that if I get a situation that doesn't meet the standard scenario, I can usually rewrite the program while I'm sitting there on the phone to make it work for a customer's particular situation. And we're going to be able to take that a step further. We're working on a project with Chase now where...
I've got a question here. We don't want to do anything that's proprietary to your company, so it's something I usually caution up early, so I'll pick up the slack on for not asking that one.
Okay.
But let me ask you, the programs, are these programs that you just have developed yourself over the years?
Yes. I basically sat down and took all the things that I did manually, like sitting down and doing a pre-qualification. You had these worksheets where you figured gross income and debt load and cash available, and I just put these into a spreadsheet, and I tried to present it in a form for the customer where the customer could see this is what assets and resources I have, and this is what I need to get into this particular house. And it basically it works.
What I'm interested in, and I think our listeners who are producers out there, I think what they're interested in is not so much the computer program itself, is how you use and manipulate it to attract business to yourself and the value added you bring to the sales transaction. And so I wondered if you would go over kind of the sales side and how people can use technology to bring loans into their portfolio.
Well, that is a process where the computer helps me with my database and helps me stay in touch with every client. It's a process that I call people farming. Each time a customer calls in here, They do not call in unless I know who referred them. That person usually gets a thank you card, and I get a lot of my business from non-realtor sources. Sometimes I can have a realtor that doesn't particularly like me or Chase or whatever reason, and I'll still get the case because three people at work or three people in that department at Virginia Tech referred them to Dennis. And a lot of times that friend or family or business associate relationship is a lot stronger and a lot more meaningful to someone who's about to make a big transaction like this than actually the realtor's recommendation. But I'll start with that. I stay in touch with past clients. I try to track their database. I know what their interest rate is. I know when interest rates turn. I basically sort the loans that I've closed by interest rate and loan sizes and know which people out there are going to be the best candidates for refinancing. They all get postcards saying that, you know, your current rate is 8% and rates have dropped to 7%. Call me about refinancing. Another thing that I do is after they've been in a house 2 or 3 years, the people that have TMI on their loans, they usually get a postcard. Last year, I bet I got 25 people out of TMI that have been in a house.
That's great. I tell everybody that everybody that I interview brings something new to the table, and I find this very interesting because you're saving your client money and you're developing an even deeper relationship because a lot of the PMI companies out there, they're just not going to let you know.
All right. Another way that I've been expanding my business beyond the boundaries of Blacksburg, Chase is a national company, so I can pretty well, unless there are licensing restrictions within any state, I've started a new program kind of called Loan Officer for Life. And as I do these follow-up things, or as I notice somebody put their house on the market, I will go back to especially previous clients and remind them that, you know, if they move to Alabama, I can do a loan there. If they move to Las Vegas, I can do a loan there. Basically, we've been pretty successful in getting some loans originated outside of Blacksburg. I get a lot of questions from people about the internet, and for a long time, people within Chase thought that I was doing production all over the country. And I don't really go. If somebody hits my website cold from South Dakota, I don't generally chase that kind of business. I chase relationships. If I've got a relationship, I'll go anywhere for a loan. But if I'm just one in 10,000 people that they found on the internet, I don't like playing the lottery.
What about the internet per se and the value to loan officers in today's environment?
Well, I see it as a time factor. I still think that the value of a professional salesperson is going to be needed when people come down to making that decision. And, you know, a classic example, you know, that I found myself in just past weekend, I went out to buy a big screen TV, and I went to two national chains, basically one chain did not have, I guess, salespeople that were commissioned. They were basically salaried salespeople, and you go in and ask questions, and you get almost no help at all. I went back to the other store that had that professional salesperson, and that's where I did my business. I got the best advice. I got more value. I got more value at the second store because I had a salesperson and knew that product inside and out. And I think in the end, I think the internet may make us all. It may weed out some people in the business, and we may have a lot more mega producers, people who just do astounding amounts of units and dollars.
On the other hand, though, I think by implication, too, the internet sites out there, the ones that are pure internet sites where they take the give you the information and then do the loan apps and stuff like that, I think people are finding statistically that they're not gravitating to these sites in large numbers other than to get information. They are doing some loans on there. There's some estimates in the next couple of years they might pick up 10 to even 15% of the amount of business, but I think a lot of them are doing like the car and some of the other websites are using it for informational purposes and then coming back and when it comes to rates and stuff, they seem to have a handle on, you know, what the market is. but they're not doing the loans on the sites per se, because they want people like you that they can look at, and if an appraisal or something goes bad, they can say, well, you know, what are we going to do about it?
Yeah, I think that in the end they need a professional salesperson, a problem solver, someone who is going to help guide them, and a lot of these terms and stuff, they can educate themselves a lot on the internet, but still, you know, what does all this mean? You know, how does it relate to me? How does it relate to my financial plan? And you know, a lot of the people, by the time they get to me to pre-qualify, it's not a matter of pre-qualifying. It's a matter of sitting down with that customer and saying, okay, what's best? You know, you've got $60,000 to put down, but what's the best thing to do? You know, should you invest that money in a house that's going to appreciate, you know, 2-4% a year, or should you put the least amount of that money into a house and take the cash now that you don't have a capital gain when you sell your primary residence? Should you take that and invest it elsewhere? And I have a good network of tax people that I work with and accountants, and I look at, you know, buying a house that is probably one of the two times that you take the closest look of your financial situation, and it's a good time to get a total financial checkup. The other time being when you do a will and maybe set up any type of family trust or anything like that. You really have to do a good inventory of your assets then. But those two times are probably the two most important times for someone to take a real look at their finances and are they doing the right thing. You mentioned value added. This is a little technique that I've done for people who understand it. I'm not an accountant. I may get shot down by this, but a lot of times if someone, just a matter of structuring a loan, one of the things that I've done is, you know, the closing costs are not tax deductible, and, you know, on a $100,000 loan, you may have $1,500 or $1,800 worth of closing costs. And one of the techniques I will do if I've got a customer who is tax savvy and understands what I'm doing is I'll charge them an origination fee or a discount point. They may be going for par price with no points and no origination fee, but what I will do is I'll charge them an origination fee or a discount point equivalent to those closing costs. We'll pay the closing costs for them. And, you know, that's a good way a loan officer can save the typical client a third. If they're in a 30% tax bracket, they can save a third on closing costs right there.
Mm-hmm. And they're bringing value added to it. And I would just have to say that if you were doing a loan for me and I didn't know about that and you did that for me, I would be very loyal indeed. And that's what this business is. It's a relationship business. I think you agree.
Yes, without a doubt. Without a doubt. And it amazes me. I've been here a long time, and every now and then I'll have a customer that will, when they go for house number two, you know, somehow maybe a realtor will lead them astray, or you know, I've had a couple name changes in the 18 or so years that I've been, or 27 years that I've been doing this, and maybe they didn't find me that second time. But what amazes me is after they have something to compare to, I usually get them back that third time. And and again, I think the relationship is extremely important.
What about the relationships with realtors? What if we switch go over the fence for a bit? And I wonder if you would discuss how you maintain your relationships and what you do to create a relationship with realtors.
Well, basically, I've been here so long, I know everybody. So usually when new agents come in and they go through the training, they get regimented as to, okay, what lenders do you go to, which ones do you avoid? And a lot of companies will basically have me to come in when they get new agents and more or less do a little dog and pony show for them about how to get started out. And I've done a couple things. I haven't updated this one in a while, but I have a little, I call it a realtor survival kit with regard to financing. And I put together several manuals that for a new agent that they can come by and get that has things like credit repair. It has, you know, it helps them calculate closing costs. And just any time I see something that I can do for an agent to help them make their life easier, I try to do. I recently just had an agency that you know, they were looking at their in-house closing cost estimate, and they wanted me to look at it for accuracy. And I looked at it, and I thought, gee, let's just do one for them. So I basically took their sheet, revised it, and put a Chase logo on it, my name on there, and now that's what they're using to you know. So every time they start thinking closing cost with a lender, they pull out a little sheet that's got my name on it.
That's great. Well, what about this handout that you give realtors? This is a real good idea. I wonder if you go into this a little bit, because there are listeners out there, or one of the reasons they're listening to you is that they're looking for an edge and looking to emulate some of the things that are successful in your career.
Well, I think a lot of people do this. This is not anything new, but when I see a new listing come on, that's another source of business. You know, you've got that person who's selling. Are they leaving the area? I can do the loan if they leave the area. Are they trading up here? I solicit that business. I also provide them a set of financing sheets with different ways to finance their house that they're trying to sell. I also give that to the realtor as well. So that they can use it to market the house. A lot of agents will religiously do it when they have open houses, but I've just found getting this type of information out in the house with all the other brochures, say the MLS sheet or a brochure on the house, sometimes people will come through that house and it may be a tad more expensive than what they think they can pay, but when they see a buy down that gets a payment very low, or they see something that, you know, gives them the tax advantages and the tax savings on the house, sometimes that extra $100 a month will allow them to get a house that they may not have attempted to do otherwise.
And I think also you engender loyalty, you not only with the listing agent, but ultimately with the selling agent and the client.
Right.
Let me ask you, what else do you do in relation to the realtors? Do you still call on realtors?
I still do. It depends. It's a function of the business. Obviously, our volume, everyone's volume, took a big slide in the second half of 1999. And, you know, my volume this year is relatively, I hear a lot of people in the industry that they're projected in year 2000 volume may be as much as 30 to 50% lower than 99, and even worse than when compared to 98. But, you know, the last 24 weeks, I've been going at an application pace that would put me on pace to do $79 million this year, and probably about, a 600 unit year. And, I market the hardest when I see, volume starting to slide. And, we worked diligently this winter. I did some mailing list. I've been trying to mail at least quarterly to people that I pre-qualified with various information about buying a house. We developed this, and I got this from another loan officer. I found that things like this, just interviewing and talking with you or talking with another loan officer, that, you know, everybody does things differently, and I think I'm nothing more than a hodgepodge of everybody that I've sponged off of as far as knowledge over the years. But we developed this little, I call it a cheat card, and this thing will have a mortgage table on it so that a customer can figure payments. And I started out using this just for realtors, and I thought, gee, the customers are the one that really needs this. So we started really mass producing them and getting them out for realtors. But it has our name and our address on it. We'll have real estate tax rates for every locality in the market that I serve. It has a list of what you need to bring in for loan application. It has a maximum loan amount for the different types of loans, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, FHA, VA. It has insurance rates for various areas, just a sampling or range that we've been able to get fairly accurate numbers from insurance agents. But we really stepped to the plate this past winter with our marketing efforts.
I like this one a lot. What is the actual physical size of this, and what does it cost you to produce these?
Basically, we just get it's kind of these little thin cardboard things, and they're about maybe 4.5 to 5 inches wide, and about it's probably like a 5x7 card, and we duplex it. And basically, I can sit here while I'm on the phone and put these cards in a printer and run 50 to 75 of them off at a time on a laser printer, and just flip them over and run the backside while I'm doing something else.
That's amazing. These things, have they been very successful? Because I like this idea. It's the first time I've heard of somebody using this.
Yeah, I think they've been very successful. The realtors like them. The customers like them. And it's a way, you've got you've got your name there and something that customer is going to keep and need as they're looking for a house. And it's just a good way to keep your name out there and keep your name with the customer.
Yeah, it's almost like what they used to call a leave behind in the business, where you can take these things, and people think that they're not very effective, but, you know, sometimes, as you and I know, low-tech is really high-tech,
right.
And it's the best form of it. They say nothing is as cheap as signage when it comes to advertising, and this is nothing more than a sign that's been reduced and has value added, I think, out there in the marketplace for everybody.
Right. Well, I was in a pharmaceutical business. We called that a service call. If we couldn't get in to see that particular doctor on that day, then we would just try to leave something to let him know that we were there, we wanted his business, and we appreciated him. And, you know, sometimes if I can't get a hold of a customer, by phone when they call, and then I try to run them down at the end of the day when I'm returning all my phone calls, then a lot of times I'll just put one of those in the mail. And they've been very successful. I've been very pleased with the results.
You gave me the size. Is this something that can be folded over and then kept in a purse or a wallet?
It's not quite that small, but it would be something that I could keep with their papers and listing sheets. And I couldn't get that much information on just a wallet card.
Mm-hmm. And it's a two. It's a, like a 5x7 on two sides.
Right.
And what I find interesting here is that, what do you have this? Do you have a spreadsheet that generates this? Or
yeah, we've got that particular one in Excel, and so basically I can go through, when we get an increase in an FHA loan limit for one of the counties, we can go through and update it. I came out with it like in the early fall and started producing it, and then at the end of the year we got new Fannie Mae limits, so we just go in and change it and update it try not to keep too big of an inventory of them, but obviously never running out and continue to produce them as we go out there.
Mm-hmm. I think this. I really like this idea. I wondered if, I think our listeners out there as they're listening to this are kind of salivating, that this is really a good idea up there with magnets that go on refrigerators that people I've talked to is another great idea that people get business years and years later from these things. What categories do you have on there? You mentioned a couple with the Freddie Fannie and FHA limits. What specifically do you try and put on there that you think will capture everybody's attention?
Well, mainly just the basics. They'll have a payment factor table so that they can figure their payments. You know, that's one of the biggest things that customers will call back for. Surprisingly, they'll pre-qualify and get payments for an $80,000 house, and then if they see one at 90, then they want to know what that payment and changes are going to be. So, you know, what we can do is immediately give them a way that they can go back and just figure what their payment's going to cost per thousand. And, you know, if they know they increase their payment $5,000 and the rates are 8%, then it's going to increase their payment to about $35 a month. Basically, the checklist is, I think, the thing that's been the most beneficial for us. We have automated underwriting now, and I effectively have underwriting in my branch because we validate the cases here in my office. I've got three different processors that are trained validators. So now it's even more crucial for that customer to be prepared when they come in. I'm getting at least probably 90% of my cases approved at point of sale right now, and it's because of electronic underwriting here in the branch, B, having validators here that can review the documents and make sure that they conform with the program guidelines, and then C, having a receptionist and an assistant who helped me do an excellent job, and working with very good realtors that helped me do a good job of getting the customer prepared when they come in here.
With your realtors, do you have an expanded base of realtors, or over the years have you narrowed it down to you have, a select 20 or so that you deal with?
I haven't really narrowed it down very much. I do try to target. I know who the producers are, and I know who the ones that are high maintenance are, and basically I try to keep sticks to, I'm looking for loyalty. I'm looking for people who do high volumes. I think the old iceberg principle where 20% of the realtors out there probably do 80% of the business, and it's true in our market, and I try to go for those. But I will get I will get work, get business from agents that I don't normally work with just because of the networking. I think that networking of previous customers is very strong. And I don't know what a loan officer can really do. I don't know that it's charisma. You just, when you do a loan, you want to give them so much service and so much information that, that it makes some type of lasting, impact. And that you can, I don't know what it is that you can do. I've never really found out exactly what it is that I do that motivates somebody to become a referral source. Other than, you know, a lot of times I find out after closing when we always mail out. I did this at my I was brought up in this business with a company called Dominion Bank Shares, and we customer surveyed every single loan. Didn't always like some of the responses I got, but even on those responses, I found that if you realized you had a problem and fixed it, even that customer could become a customer service referral source. But when we send out these letters, one of the questions we ask is, you know, would you recommend Dennis Duncan or would you recommend Chase Manhattan to your friends and family and colleagues? And if they say yes, then you've got a contract. And so I follow up on that and send them a letter thanking you for agreeing to recommend people to use Chase Manhattan. Here's some additional business cards. Feel free to call anytime. And I think that's my biggest source. It's not really the realtors, but really the existing people, the client base that I've dealt with.
I think there's a lesson to be learned by our listeners out there. I won't profess to have that lesson in absolute form, but I do think what you're saying here is that doing your business, getting your realtor business, business is a long-term proposition. It's done over a number of years. And if you can develop these people, these customers that are so valued, at some point in the relationship, as you say, you're doing only about 30% realtor business now, and the rest is referrals.
Right, and you're spreading your risk. From a risk standpoint, if you put all your eggs in one basket, with 5 or 10 agents, and those guys either get out of the business, die off, or leave, or for any number of reasons, and the turnover in the business is pretty high, then you've got yourself exposed. So, you know, in my mind, if you've got 8,000 previous customers out there, those are all walking, talking advertisements if you can motivate them to do it.
How many people do you have out there in your customer base? It must be a monster.
I've done right at 8,000 loans, 8,000 to 9,000 loans, you know, since I got into business, and obviously some of those people have moved on, passed away, and I think right now I've got at least an active, alumni database of probably about 2,800 people.
Mm-hmm. What would you recommend for loan officers that are out there? Would you recommend programs like ACT or some sort of a database management for themselves?
I think yes, especially for people that may not be that computer literate. I've never used a canned program like that. I can pretty well take Lotus and sort it and do anything I want to do with Lotus and that type of thing. So I think some type of a contact management system would do the job.
Mm-hmm.
Basically we just acquired a product that does it that way. So I keep two databases. I keep my database and then I'll keep one for my company as well.
Mm. That's amazing. Let me ask you something. When it comes to working outside the box, do you seem to allude that you also work with attorneys and with CPAs and others. I wonder if you go into that just a little bit.
Oh, yes. I mean, basically, divorce attorneys are a good source of business. And a lot of those actually close loans, but I get a fair number of business. I always laugh. I said people could never buy homes again, but because of divorces, unfortunately, it's a sad state. But there will always be a certain amount of refinance business out there, even when the rates are as high as they are right now. Tax preparers. We weren't in a refinance mode this tax season, but I managed to get out a mailing to all the CPAs and accountants and tax preparers, basically just reminding them, hey, when you're preparing people's taxes, if they've got equity in their homes and you're noticing a lot of consumer debt that's not tax deductible, let's do something about that. I mean, that's a way that the tax person can give some value added to their client and also create some business for Chase and for Dennis.
Let me ask you something about, we're doing this interview at 7:30 in the morning, but as you clearly stated when we got on, you've been actually in since 6 o'clock, which means you probably got up around the time I got up at 5. What about your personal work habits? Are they very structured and disciplined, and would you recommend that people, you know, have a structured discipline of some sort?
Well, I think loan officers by nature are probably not that disciplined or are structured, but you know, I have people who, I've got one loan officer that I'm kind of mentoring with Chase, who comes up to work with me maybe once every 12 to 18 months. But the biggest reason, I see loan officers who are out there that go to all the seminars, and they go to Jeff Elias, and they'll go to Todd Duncan, and they'll purchase tapes and all this stuff. But the biggest thing that it comes right down to is work ethic and applying all these things that you hear about from other loan officers. You've got to actually do it. You've got to get the repetitions, and obviously, I think the more loans you do, the better you get.
Well, what about your personal work habits? Obviously, they start pretty early in the morning, and I think we also can extrapolate from some of the things you said that you must set aside certain periods of time as, you know, mail out time, work time, database management, whatever you want to call it. And I wonder if you go over some of your personal work habits.
Well, I use the morning to come in, and that's when the first hour or two is when I'm really running my office and doing the inner office stuff and some of the marketing. Right now, I'm doing a lot of the spreadsheets. I have an employee that's been out sick for almost a month, but basically, I spend the early morning doing the paperwork, and then obviously from 9 to 5, it's basically one appointment after another most days. I've been very fortunate to acquire an assistant who can take the applications now, and that's taken a big burden off of me so that I can spend more of my time marketing and pre-qualifying. Really, the sale is made to pre-qualify. I feel like if I do the job well and ask for the business and sell it up at the pre-qualify stage, then the sale is made there. Then it's just a matter of getting the person scheduled, getting them in, and meeting with me or my assistant to get the ball rolling.
Do you try and get FaceTime with each of your clients when they come in, even if you don't do the loan app?
Yeah, I do, even if it's just, and my assistant's good. She likes for me to at least do that because she sees if I don't get to see them. So I do at least, and sometimes what I do, if it's an easy case, she'll get everything in a computer and run it through automated underwriting and get the approval, and then I go over and do, and I tell the customer, I said, I'm here, this is just, you could fill out your application, I could give you the computer, and you could type this information in, but, what I want to do is the important thing, the thing that's going to impact you for the next, 7 or 8 years as you're making those payments, and that's structurally financing, and make sure we do what's in your best interest and get you the best program and get something that, matches your financial profile.
What about, do you work nights and weekends?
I do, more than I would probably like to admit, but I do put in a lot of calls over the weekend. I use the weekend as a mechanism to catch up on phone calls and maybe run down people that I've missed during the week. I keep the website open all weekend. I have a dedicated phone line when I'm at home, so I can I can just periodically walk by my office at home and catch pre-quals as they come in. I got two yesterday afternoon, Sunday afternoon, and I was on the phone with a customer Sunday night about 8:30, and probably both of those will convert to appointments for this week.
I dread asking you about a personal life. We don't ask, in the interviews about a specific, how many kids are you married to, that kind of thing, but do you try and have a personal life? Can you get one?
Yeah, I do. I've got a very understanding family.
I think you do.
A wife, and two kids, and they know. But I'll tell you this, my son's he's pretty bright about things. Somebody asked my son if he wanted to do what his dad does one day, and he'll be 13 this summer, and this must have been 5 years ago, 4 years ago, and my son looked up at him and said, no, I don't want to work that hard.
well, this is a hard business. I think that a lot of loan officers out there forget that, you know, especially those that get caught in some of these refi booms where the loans just keep rolling in, and they never bother to do the relationships and get their purchase money business in order, and later on they suffer from it.
Yeah, I think so too. I think I think each customer, anytime you talk with somebody about a mortgage, we mentioned attorneys and financial planners and accountants, builders. There are a lot of successful loan officers. You mentioned someone that that is a colleague of mine from years back, Alex Wish, up in Northern Virginia.
Fabulous. Interviewed him a couple weeks.
He has probably one of the greatest builder bases of business of anybody in the country. And in my market is not large enough. I have to go. I have to cross section my market a little bit more, and that's good in my situation, because it spreads the risk. I don't have all my business coming from one particular source.
Well, I would think at this point in time, after the number of years, that you really are literally not realtor dependent anymore.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, the realtors are there. I appreciate them. I enjoy working with them. They're fun. But there's a lot of different ways to succeed in this business, and that realtors are one part of the puzzle.
Yeah. I'd like to ask you one final question, because we're kind of getting out of time now, and that is, I wonder if just for the loan officers out there, if you would maybe just spend 2 or 3 minutes just talking about relationship selling and the value of relationships in this business in a general macro sense.
I think a key thing is, basically we're providing a service, and we're providing that hit home with that purchase of the TV this weekend. Basically what kind of product knowledge, what kind of advice, what kind of financial plan you give to the customer in the end. I think that's what I have an expression that when someone is shopping me and playing me a little bit, my favorite expression is value is a function of price plus service. And I really believe in that, and I think basically, I've had a couple of cases. I had a friend with Coca-Cola refer one of his employees to me a few years ago, and I didn't get the case, and I really, I felt bad about it, but, it's just one case you got to pick up and go. But, the feedback I got from my friend was, hey, my employee said, out of everybody they talked to, and they must have talked to 20 loan officers, they got more help and more information. I don't know, I think it was price. It came down to price, and a lot of times, that's part of my job is to determine, okay, what's the thing that's going to trigger? And if it's purely price, then I start weaning my time back need to start weaning my time back right away. I don't care what company you're with. You're not going to have the best price out there day in and day out. So it's the things that you can control that you've got to, make sure that you do your job. And, there have been days where I'm sure we might have been the worst person on the street or worst lender on the street, but we got the business because the rest of that equipment.
I think that's a great point for our listeners out there, and I think this is a good high point to end this. I want to thank you very much, Dennis, for taking the time to talk for our listeners out there. Certainly appreciate you. A lot of good points, a lot of new points that have never come up in the interviews that I've done, which is actually kind of normal, but not in the number that have come up today. And for that, I want to thank you very much.
Thank you, John.
Great. Thanks so much, Dennis. Bye.